If you bring verses into it, in Thailand at least, it's religious. And it's churchianity, and it's they've had enough of that. But very seldom do people turn down a story. I have a story to tell you. There was a paralyzed man. There's his knee, and there's his head.
My name's Josh. Welcome to Bible Memory Gold. This is part two of my interview with Dr. Larry Dinkins. We're talking about orality, which is the tradition of passing down the stories of the Bible orally, out loud, as opposed to the very strict word-for-word memorization that we tend to do in the literate West. Now, if you haven't already seen the first interview, I recommend you do that to get some context around what orality is. And today, Dr. Dinkins is going to give us some really practical ideas on how that looks and how he teaches that to the Thai people here in Thailand.
So if you just started out with a basic, simply the story approach, then you always want to have a small group. We always work in what we call a tribe, and we help them to absorb the story at the beginning of our training. So we would pray first, obviously, and then we would learn the story. And the way it's learned is one person would read it from a good version. I think any dynamic equivalent type portion is wise.
Can you explain what you mean by that?
Yeah,
that's like the NIV, the ESV. Okay. I use NASV, which is more literate.
Okay.
But that's just what I got used to 40 years ago.
Sure.
Basically, you read from just a good translation. And then you close it and you have the people, actually we have them close their eyes and we often have them hold their hands like this because as you listen, you can kinetically move with the story as you hear it. And the last session I talked about the storm story.
Yeah.
So as I told the story, I'd encourage them to actually do the movement, go to the other side,
yeah.
Dismiss the crowd. There's little boats that go with them. So basically you're helping them listen, close their eyes because the concentration is better, use their body as they're listening. And then you close it, you ask someone to retell it, and they'll get 50%, let's say. You read it again, close it, and you might say, okay, now start changing maybe a few of the pronouns to proper names because you're reading prose. Prose has lots of pronouns. If you don't have the context, you're in trouble because you don't know who James or John, who's being mentioned.
So if we're saying he, instead of saying he,
they, she, it.
Jesus. Or the disciples,
right?
You're changing it so that you know as you're saying it or the people that are listening know exactly who that pronoun is.
That's right. But in rote memory, if you memorized with your method, which is more of a rote memory, you're going to have a whole bunch of pronouns.
Correct.
But when you sit down at a table to retell that to somebody and it's a story and you just use pronouns, that guy's going to go, well, I don't know who he, she is. So that's a good principle. So that's my encouragement is Bible memory of story narrative sections. Changing a few, not all of them, but a few of the key pronouns to proper names makes sense.
Yeah.
And saying it in your own words, which means you're going to go faster in your absorption of it because you're not hung up word for word.
Yeah.
And you do that, say, three times. I've seen groups on maybe just 6, 7, 8 verses. They're at 95%. Hmm. And then as we delve more into the story, they're going to get it up to 100%. So there's, and then we always have them stand up and we want them to speak out loud. I think memory without speaking out loud, you're losing one of the good deep tracks that form in your brain.
Yeah.
So we just use basic kinetic movement, close your eyes, see the graphic. So we're using a few things that really enhance your absorption of scripture. And I use the word absorption because when you say memory, people always think immediately, I need to know this rote.
Yeah.
And people get hung up and they go into shock almost when you don't let them use notes. And we're not relying on printed Bibles. We're really processing through oral.
Yeah.
After that, we're going to unpack it. We're going to ask basic questions so that we can do observations of that story, but in an oral way.
Yeah.
And then application at the end. I'm not going to so much emphasize the whole process of doing inductive Bible study oral style, but I think just first and foremost is how do you learn a story in an oral way?
Yeah.
And then say, I have actually absorbed, just as you would say, I've memorized Romans.
Yeah.
I have, as I showed this sheet more than once, 100 stories. So there's my kind of data sheet of Scripture, and you're hoping for the New Testament.
Yeah,
you might not make it by the... But that's a goal. I have a goal of maybe having a whole bunch of stories in my database because I'm a missionary and I really want to see Thai people come to Christ.
Mm-hmm.
The nice thing about having all these is I size up the felt need of a person. I can do evangelism. I can do discipleship in a small group. I can use this approach. And Josh, I preach using this. So I'm not in the pulpit. I don't use notes. I ask questions of the congregation. Yeah. And then my key is, can they retell that story as they leave? So we talked about how often we kind of have an abstract discussion, theoretical discussion about memory.
Yeah.
I'm going to give you hopefully a more practical one and hopefully teach you a story.
Please do.
My leader of my group says, are you going to talk about chocolate and how good it is? No. Eat the chocolate. Yes. Experience it.
Yes.
So I would usually just tell this story, but for sake of time, mm-hmm. I'm going to go right into an object lesson that I've used to help people remember and tell a story. And the reason I hand this out, I've made almost 2,000 of these, is because I believe there will be more retelling of Scripture because they've experienced a way of getting a story and being able to tell it with the object lesson.
Okay.
The basic approach is you don't need any object lessons. This is just fun. Okay. So you're going to get one of these. I'm not giving you the big one.
All right.
And I want the people at home to realize that these are just tongue depressors. Yes. And I put a hole in them with a really strong punch, and I put a brad in three different places. So you have four tongue depressors that are all connected, and that's all that there is to this. And like I said, I made 2,000 of them. So I'm going to go very slowly through a story from the book of Mark.
Okay.
And it's where the paralyzed man is let down through the hole in the ceiling, right?
Okay.
Okay. After many days, and you can follow me here, Jesus came to Capernaum. So we got a C going here. C.
Yep.
And Jesus was in the house. The houses were flat top back then, yes. Right? Yeah. And so many people gathered in the house, there was no room even at the door.
Ah, at the door. There's no room.
And Jesus was speaking the word of God to them. So there's my Bible, right?
Okay.
There was a paralyzed man. There's his knee and there's his head.
Gotcha.
He was on a mat and picked up by four men. And you want the sharp end of the four to point to your right shoulder.
Yeah.
Okay. They brought the man to Jesus, but they were not able to get through because of all the people gathered, the crowd gathered at the door, right? So they
went up to the roof.
And they tore up some of the roof and dug. So here's my digging. They dug a hole. There's my hole. Then they let the paralyzed man down right in front of Jesus. Jesus saw the faith of the four men.
Yep.
And he said to the paralyzed man, my son, your sins are forgiven. Now, the scribes have long beards.
Oh, yes.
The scribes, they were reasoning in their hearts. Make sure your heart's on the left side. Yes.
Yeah.
And the scribes were saying, what is this man saying? This is blasphemy. Who can forgive sin but God alone? Now, Jesus, who has a shorter beard.
Yeah, of course.
Jesus sensed in his spirit what the scribes were thinking. I usually do this for first graders, so if I'm going too fast for you, Josh.
This is great.
Jesus said, why are you reasoning in your hearts? What is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, take up your bed and walk? But in order that you might know that the Son of Man has authority on earth, so here's my earth, mm-hmm. Then he said to the paralyzed man, arise, take up your bed and go home. And this is where the miracle occurs. Then he got up and he started to walk. Let me get him walking here. He started walking.
I figured that might be where you're headed with that. Yeah.
I mean, he was really excited. You can see here. And everyone was amazed. And they began to praise God. And they said to one another, we have never seen anything like this. And you, Josh, have never seen anything like this.
I have not. No, this is the first time anything like this has been used in this studio to share.
And you have two children.
Oh, they would love this. Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
And obviously the reason I'm doing this, I'm hoping people at home we'll go down and get the implements to do this, because this could be done by children. One time I told this 140 times over a weekend.
Wow.
And I handed out these to groups of families. So when I'm in my sleep, I can go through this story because I've told it so many times.
Yeah.
And what would be interesting, if you were to take a Bible, I probably got over 95% accuracy. And if you asked me to do it really accurately, you know, I could just sit down to try to get through it that way.
Yeah.
What I like about this is every single aspect of that story has a movement.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever you can add sensory to your telling, and that's the reason why story is so easily absorbed, there are so many sensory elements that probably don't come through in Romans, in the book of Ephesians. And that's your disadvantage of going through more didactic material as trying to memorize that as your first approach.
Yeah.
But starting someone out with this and they go, oh, I got 7 or 8 verses. Last week I had no verses.
Yeah.
And I don't have to do much review. You do want to review. And you would tell them, you know, where this is found in Mark so they can, you know, go through it again.
Yeah.
But that is probably a taste of training. Like I said, we don't use object lessons. We just do it truly oral without print. Mm-hmm. The Bible we have in our hand, because that's our template, and we always read from the Bible. But we want them to get it in their heart pocket.
Yeah.
And then the power of it all is retelling. I think I've said more than once, I appreciate Bible memory, but let's make sure that we are replicating, training others. Discipleship is the end-all be-all, right? Jesus' Great Commission is you want to baptize, you want to train people to be obedient. And however you can get people excited about taking in more scripture, man, I'm in favor of it.
Yeah.
And with my Thai people, this has been the approach. So.
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously this would be a hit on a Sunday school, you know, like a Sunday school. But I think I don't know. I at some point when we hit our 20s or something, we start to think that it's just too childish.
Mm-hmm.
But it's those childish things that can really stick in our brains sometimes a lot.
Josh, what I think is very important to remember is, I think it's Matthew 13:34, that Jesus never taught without a parable. A parable is a story. He is the consummate oral communicator, and we are to follow. Paul said, I follow Christ, right? Mm-hmm. You follow me as I follow Christ. We are to follow Christ. If he was the best communicator ever to live, and he used only story, from chapter 3:13 on in Matthew, it says he never spoke without using a parable. That really convicted me. I need to get more parables. I need to get more story under my belt so that I have fuel for evangelism, for my discipleship, for small groups, for preaching. And then you say, what about the epistles? Well, there are certain parts of the epistles that I can do with the same approach. There's parts of James which are very practical, very movement-oriented, and suddenly you can start to get sections of epistles. Or Rome. I love Revelation chapter 4. I just said it the other day in one of my presentations because it's so picturesque. You know, it's just so graphic.
Yeah.
So just start thinking, maybe my advice is work more on stories, individual stories that are maybe not more than 15 verses that have more action than dialogue. I know John 11 and John 4, but there's lots of dialogue, and I don't want to mess up the dialogue. So they're much more harder to absorb.
Yeah.
Other parts, like the storm story, it's almost all action.
Yeah.
And start out your disciple in memory with something that they get success with.
Yeah.
And then they build on that to the point where I want to memorize the whole New Testament or something.
Yeah.
That's great. But in my Thai church, people are not memorizing. I need to get them going and get them jump-started.
Yeah.
So that's my plea is start out with success and then build on that.
Yeah. So to somebody, let's say there's somebody listening to this or watching this that says, you know, hey, I've been frustrated by rote memory. Like it's just, I feel like I keep doing it and then a month later I come back and I've forgotten it. It feels like I'm re-memorizing it all over again. What would you say to somebody that says, okay, I'm willing to give this story or this orality type of approach something, you know, just try to dive into that. What would be the best place to start? Where would they start with that?
I think what I might do is give you a list of stories that are less than the 15 verses that are very optimum. I use the word optimal or optimum, meaning shorter stories that have action in them. I can give you a list of those. Mm-hmm. I have a list here of my 100 stories. Now, some of them are longer than that.
Yeah.
But if you ask me how to start someone out and getting more scripture quickly, let's say you get 10 stories of 10 verses apiece. That's 100 verses. And I believe you could get that quite quickly with the most optimum stories.
Yeah.
When you get those and you start thinking, okay, I'll do a little bit longer story or maybe one that has more dialogue.
Yeah. So instead of thinking of it in terms of, hey, what are the single verses, the collection of verses about love or something that I want, what you're saying is, hey, let's take a collection of stories that can be hopefully even used in day-to-day life and conversation and turn those 5 to 7 to 10 verses into something that you can now retell in your own words using maybe pronouns that would help make the story easier to retell.
Right. A story in your marriage, Josh, talking story rather than pulling out individual verses on submission or something.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You could go through all sorts of verses individual. But I think when you talk about a love relationship between Boaz, Ruth, or something, or you go to stories of Isaac and Rebecca, I'm just thinking there are many stories that are life and blood experiences that can be winsomely brought into conversation. If you bring verses into it, in Thailand at least, it's religious.
Yeah.
And it's churchianity, and they've had enough of that. But very seldom do people turn down a story. I have a story to tell you. And I see it working with kids. I have 9 grandkids. And that's the one thing I want to do is I want to tell them stories. Because that's what they'll remember their grandpa for.
Yeah.
And I've seen it work in marriages. I've seen it work in family situations. I struggle with devotions because I was bringing out individual verses. I wish I would have just given some good stories and had those kids actually replicate them. So once again, whatever can be repeated easily is what I'm interested in. Don't teach anything that's not easily repeatable.
Yeah.
Because 2 Timothy 2:2 says we need to pass on generationally. We need to package whatever we're doing in a way that can be passed down. If what we do ends up just with us, it may bless us devotionally and spiritually. But the question is, are we fulfilling the Great Commission? Are we actually equipping and training people to actually do what we can do?
Yeah.
And that I've told you that, you know, kind of in our conversation is, I'm a missionary here 42 years. Missions really lends itself to what I'm talking about. I want it to be passed on.
Yeah. Well, what I would like to do is for any of you that are watching or listening right now, if you go to BibleMemoryGoal.com/stories, I'm going to make sure that we have a PDF that you can download that lists off a number of these stories that, you know, would be advisable for somebody if you wanted to start diving into stories. Here's a list of some of them that you can start jumping into right now. Dr. Dinkins, thank you so much again.
Yeah, and probably the easiest way also to add to that list would be Simply the Story. If you just Google Simply the Story, it has 160-page handbook. So those who love literacy, all the explanations that I've given very succinctly can be expanded on that website.
Great.
So I would highly encourage you to go to that website, Simply the Story.